Dear laureates, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure for me to introduce the Nobel Prize in Physics. We are talking about neutrinos. Neutrinos have very interesting and fascinating properties. They are very abundant. They are almost as abundant as photons. There are many billions of neutrinos in this room. At this moment, they travel almost at the speed of light. Neutrinos are very elusive particles. They interact via the weak interaction with a very short range. That means that they travel in this room and they are not affected. They travel through Earth without being absorbed or anything. They just go through. Neutrinos have three flavors. They can be electron, muon, or tau. And they can change flavor, and this is this year's Nobel Prize discovery. They oscillate. We are talking about neutrino oscillation. Neutrinos have a mass, and this is because of this year's prize discovery. They were assumed to be without mass. Now we know that they have a mass. Very small mass, but since there are so many of them, this is a large mass. And this is changing our understanding of the universe. The discovery was made in two scientific collaborations, one in Japan with a prominent scientist, Professor Takayuki Kayita, it's called Super Kamiokande. They were looking at neutrinos, atmospheric neutrinos created when cosmic radiation interacts with the molecules of the atmosphere. The second collaboration is in Canada, Sudbury Neutrino Observatory collaboration led by Professor Arthur MacDonald. It's now time for me to introduce the first Nobel laureate, Professor Takayuki Kayita. He was born in March 1959 at Higashi Matsuyama, Japan. He studied first at Saitama University and then at the University in Tokyo, where he got his PhD in 1986. And since 1988, he has been at the Institute for Cosmic Radiation Research. In 1999, he became professor at the University of Tokyo and is director of the Institute for Cosmic Ray Research. So, Professor Kayita, please.
Good morning. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank the very kind introduction. And also, I want to mention that this is really the greatest honor for me to give this lecture today. Today, I'm going to discuss discovery of atmospheric neutrinos. Well, the outline of this talk is shown here. First, I have an introduction. That is the introduction of the Kamiokande experiment. That was the starting point of my research. Then I want to discuss the atmospheric neutrino deficit. And then the discovery of neutrino oscillations, recent results and the future. Then I'll summarize, and finally I want to mention the acknowledgement. Now, introduction. Well, in the late 1970s, new theories that unify strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces were proposed. These theories predicted that protons and neutrons, namely nucleons, should decay with the lifetime of approximately 32. This is long enough to think about the real effect. However, these are short enough to observe the proton decays. Therefore, several proton decay experiments began in early 1980s, and one of them was the Kamiokande experiment. No laser, lasers. Well, okay. This is the photo of the Kamiokande experiment. It is a 3 kiloton water Cherenkov detector, and the fiducial mass for the analysis of neutrino events or proton decays was about 1 kilotons. And I'd like to tell you the basics of this experiment. Yeah. Well, if a charged, relativistic charged, charged particle propagate in water, then they emit Cherenkov light. And these photons, Cherenkov lights, are detected by photon detectors that are placed on the wall of the detector. And you can see these dots are actually photon detectors. And I want to mention that initially, Kamiokande was rather a small experiment. Well, this was the, I would say, construction team in spring of 1983. And you can see here, is Professor Koshiba, who is the Nobel laureate in physics in year 2002. And also you can see Professor Totsuka, Professor Kifune, and also you can see students maybe 2-3 meters behind Professor Koshiba. And one of them was me. Well, okay. There was already an introduction of neutrinos. Therefore, for this page, I could be short. But let me repeat. Neutrinos are fundamental particles like electrons and quarks. They have no electric charge. And they have three types or three flavors: electron neutrinos, muon neutrinos, and tau neutrinos. And they are produced in various places, such as the Earth atmosphere or center of the sun. And they can easily penetrate through the Earth, or maybe even the sun. So if a neutrino is produced here, they can easily propagate through the Earth, unfortunately also through the detector, and go to the space. But, well, they can, however, interact with matter very rarely. If neutral interaction occurs, nu mu produces a muon, and nu e produces an electron. And also, I want to mention that in the very successful standard model of particle physics, neutrinos are assumed to be to have no mass. However, physicists have been asking, neutrinos really have no mass. Now, I want to move on to the atmospheric neutrino deficit. Well, I want to explain a little bit. Cosmic ray particles entering in the atmosphere interact with the air nucleus. Then these interactions typically produce pions, and then these pions decay to muons, to electrons, and in this decay chain, 2 muon neutrinos and 1 electron neutrinos are produced. And these are observed in underground detectors. Now, I want to mention a little bit my work in early days. I got my PhD in March 1986 based on the search for proton decay. Well, of course, I didn't find any proton decay. But anyway, I felt that the analysis software was not good enough to select the signal that is proton decays from the background, that is the atmospheric neutrino interactions, most efficiently. Therefore, as soon as I submitted my thesis, I began to work to improve the software. And one of them was the analysis software to identify the particle type for multi-Cherenkov ring events. Namely, I wanted to know if, say, each Cherenkov ring in a multi-ring event is produced by an electron or muon. For example, this is an observed event in Kamiokande. And you can see three Cherenkov rings here, and I wanted to know if they are produced by a muon or an electron. Anyway, the new software was ready and was applied to single Cherenkov ring events, which were the easiest events to analyze. So it's natural to start from the easiest thing. Then, the neutrino flavor was studied for the atmospheric neutrino events. These are the typical events observed in Kamiokande. This is a typical event pattern for electron neutrino interaction. This is the typical event pattern for muon neutrino interaction. And we immediately found that the result was strange. The number of muon neutrino events was much fewer than expected. Well, at first I thought that I made some serious mistake. In order to know where I made mistake, I decided to scan the events. And immediately I realized that the analysis software was right. However, I was not optimistic yet. I thought that it's very likely that there were some mistakes somewhere in the simulation, data reduction, and or event reconstruction. So we, that means mostly Takita-san and myself, started various studies to find mistakes in the late 1986. Well, actually, after more than 1 year of studies, we concluded that new mu deficit cannot be due to any major problem in the data analysis nor the simulation. And therefore, Kamiokande decided to publish this result. And well, basically, in this paper, in this publication, we reported these numbers. The number of electron neutrino events observed was 93, while the predicted number was 88.5. So basically, they agree. However, for the muon neutrino events, the number of observed events in the data was 85, while the prediction was 144. It's clear that there is a deficit in the new mu events. And in the paper, we concluded that we are unable to explain the data as the result of systematic detector effects or uncertainties in the atmospheric neutrino fluxes, some as yet unaccounted for physics, such as neutrino oscillations, might explain the data. Well, at this stage, this is still might. However, Well, I got very much excited. And well, I want to mention my personal memory. Well, I was mostly excited with the possibility of neutrino oscillations with large mixing angle. Namely, nu mu seems to oscillate maximally to the other neutrino type, and this maximal oscillation was not expected. Therefore, I got excited, and this gave me the strong motivation to continue the study. Now, I mentioned neutrino oscillations, so I want to explain a little bit about neutrino oscillations. This was also mentioned already at the beginning, therefore I would not be very precise. But anyway, if neutrinos have masses, neutrinos change their flavor or type from one flavor to the other. For example, oscillations could occur between muon neutrinos and tau neutrinos. And if a muon neutrino is produced here, then if they propagate long distances, they disappear, and if they propagate even further, they reappear. And if propagate further, disappear again, reappear again. And if muon neutrinos disappear, then tau neutrinos appear. So this is the neutrino oscillation. And one important thing is, if the neutrino mass is smaller, the oscillation length, that is, well, for this figure, maybe this distance, gets longer. So in order to study small neutrino masses, you have to study neutrinos that travel long distances. And also, I want to mention that these are theoretically predicted by these people, Maki, Nakagawa, Sakata, and Pontecorvo. Now, so far, I have discussed the Kamiokande result, but, well, there was other experiment called IMB. That was another large water Cherenkov detector, and they also reported the deficit of muon neutrino events. So, that is encouraging. However, well, we thought that the simple deficit of muon neutrino events is not really enough to conclude to be neutrino oscillations. We wanted to have more positive evidence for oscillations. Then, well, actually the physics is simple. If neutrinos are produced in the upper atmosphere of a detector, then the travel length for neutrinos are short enough. Therefore, they have no time to oscillate. However, if a neutrino is produced in the other side of the Earth, then they need to travel long distances before reaching to the detector, so they may oscillate. Therefore, we conclude that we should observe the deficit of upward-going muon neutrinos. And in fact, Kamiokande tried to see this effect, and well, we studied, but we see some effect. However, it was clear that Kamiokande was not big enough to be conclusive. Therefore, it's clear that we needed much larger detector, and therefore we needed super Kamiokande. Now, I want to move on to the neutrino oscillation discovery. Well, of course, the discovery was made by the super Kamiokande experiment. It is a 50 kiloton water Cherenkov detector, and the fiducial mass that is used for the oscillation studies is 22.5 kilotons, which is more than 20 times larger than the fiducial mass of Kamiokande. And this is a big experiment and big international collaboration we have about 120 collaborators from these countries. I said this is an international collaboration, and in fact, this is an international collaboration from the beginning of the construction. And this photo shows the initial discussion about the Super Kamiokande collaboration between Japan and the United States. And here you can see Professor Tosca, who was the spokesperson of the Super Kamiokande. And also you can see various key people in this photo. And this photo was taken at the Institute for Cosmic Ray Research, probably in 1991 or 1992. Now, this is the photo of the Super Kamiokande detector. Well, this was taken in January 1996, and you can see the pure water was filled up to this level, and you can realize how big the detector is. If you notice three people on a rubber boat. Anyway, the Super Kamiokande detector was constructed and started the data taking in April 1996. And since then, Super Kamiokande has been observing lot of atmospheric neutrino events. This is the typical single Cherenkov ring event observed in Super Kamiokande. In addition, we have these events, and you can clearly see two Cherenkov rings in the event. Furthermore, we have this kind of event. This is the neutrino interaction occurring in the detector, but the charged particle, in this case muon, penetrates through the inner detector, and you can in fact see the signal in the outer detector. In addition, we have yet another sample, that is the upward going muons. Here, the neutrino interact in the rock below the detector, and only a muon is observed. Here, you can see a muon enter from this point and exited at this point. So these muons come from below and penetrate to the top. And I want to mention that all these events are used in the analysis, and each event have a very different event topology. Therefore, we need to work coherently and collaborative work of many people, or more exactly, many young people were essential to the discovery. Anyway, after 2 years from the beginning of the Super Kamiokande experiment, we conclude that the data gave the evidence for neutrino oscillations. And this is the slide used in neutrino conference in 1998. And this is the most important plot in that presentation. Well, let me explain a little bit. Well, this is the zenith angle distribution, and cosine theta equal 1 means neutrinos coming from above. Cosine theta equal minus 1 means neutrinos are coming from below. And you see that for neutrinos coming from above, the observed data, which are shown by the black dot, are in agreement with the prediction, which is shown by these squares. However, if we look at the neutrinos coming from the other side of the Earth, we clearly see the deficit. And from this result, together with the other data, Super Kamiokande concluded that the observed zenith angle dependent deficit, this one, and the other supporting data gave evidence for neutrino oscillations. Well, so far I discussed the result from Super Kamio Kande. At that time, there were other atmospheric neutrino experiments. They are Macro in Italy and Sudan II in the United States. These experiments observed atmospheric neutrinos and confirmed neutrino oscillations. Therefore, the neutrino oscillation was quickly accepted by the neutrino community. Now, in the remaining time, I want to discuss a little bit about the results, well, recent results and the future. Well, I said, essentially based on this distribution, we concluded that neutrinos oscillate. Well, it was very nice that to see that the approximately half of the long-traveling muon neutrinos disappear. However, we think that we want to really confirm neutrino oscillations. And if we look at the prediction, so oscillation probability as a function of log of distance should be like this. So we really wanted to observe this dip in order to confirm really neutrinos oscillate. And therefore, well, Super Kamio Kande carried out a special analysis. And in fact, observed the deep, well, the deep is not as deep as this deep, but anyway, this is the data, the depth of the deep is just consistent with the prediction if we consider the detector resolution. So it's, we are very happy that the deep was seen at this position and this really tells us that neutrinos really oscillate. Well, we discussed the neutrino oscillation discovery in 1998. Super Kamio Kande is still taking data. And I would like to compare the neutrino data in 1998 and the data so far accumulated. At neutrino conference in 1998, we used 531 events in order to produce this plot. And if we do the same now, then the number of events used in this plot is 5,485. So we have 10 times larger data sample, and we are continuing detailed studies of neutrino oscillations. And here, at this point, I want to mention two main results. Well, first of all, heaviest neutrino mass is approximately 10 million times smaller than the electron mass, which is the, actually the lightest particle except for neutrinos. So you can realize that neutrinos mass is really, really, really tiny. In addition, we found that new mu oscillate maximally to new taus, which is to me really surprising, and we really want to understand why. Now, I want to mention a little bit about the overall history or development of neutrino oscillation experiments. As I said, the early new mu deficit was concluded to be neutrino oscillations, and this discovery motivated the accelerator-based neutrino oscillation experiments to further study oscillation effect. And these studies, together with the updated atmospheric neutrino data, requires the full three-flavor oscillation effects. And well, this effect was, biggest effect was already observed by these experiments. However, the story is not complete yet. The neutrino community is trying to understand further which could be the most important parameter to be observed. So I would say that our understanding on neutrino oscillations have been improving tremendously. However, we still have to understand neutrinos more. Now, I'll summarize. Unexpected muon neutrino deficit in the atmospheric neutrino flux was observed in Kamiokande in 1988. Subsequently, after 10 years, in 1998, Super Kamiokande discovered neutrino oscillations, which shows that neutrinos have mass. I feel that I have been extremely lucky because I have been involved in the excitement of this discovery from the beginning. The discovery of non-zero neutrino masses opened a window to study physics beyond the standard model of elementary particle physics, probably that of the grand unification of elementary particle interactions. There are still many things to be observed in neutrinos, and further studies of neutrinos might give us fundamental information for the understanding of the nature, such as the origin of the matter in the universe. Well, before concluding, I would like to acknowledge people who contributed to the discovery. First of all, I want to thank collaborators of Kamiokande and Super Kamiokande experiments. In particular, I would like to thank Masatoshi Koshiba and Yoji Totsuka for their continuing support of and encouragement of my research throughout my career. Ed Kahns worked with me on the analysis of atmospheric neutrinos in Super Kamiokande for many years. Masato Takita and Kenji Kaneyuki worked with me in the Kamiokande analysis. Yoichi Totsuka, Yoichiro Suzuki, and Masayuki Nakahata have been leading the Super Kamiokande experiment. Hank Sobel and Jim Stone have been leading the US effort of Super Kamiokande. Kenzo Nakamura and Atsuto Suzuki played very important roles in the early stage of the Super Kamiokande experiment. And last, and maybe the most important, hard work by young collaborators of Super Kamiokande was essential for the discovery. And I also want to thank Morihiro Honda for the neutrino flux calculation. And finally, Super Kamiokande acknowledges mixed DOE and Kamioka Mining and Smelting Company. Well, thank you very much for your attention.